Dear students of Department of English, Assam University, Silchar, I have the pleasure to forward a lecture on George Skinner's contribution to translation for your forthcoming final semester examination. As you know, translation is really a difficult art, and the history of translation goes back to the ancient Greek and Roman civilization down to the present times, and more predominantly, translation as a discourse became all the more popular in the 20th century, and so far as the post-colonial translation is concerned, there were literary, linguistic and cultural theories of translation, and there came a coterie of critics who forwarded philosophical theories of translation, among them the names of Jacques Derrida, Walter Benjamin, Ezra Pound, George Skinner stand prominent. Whereas Derrida talks about relevant translation and the relevance of deconstructive approach to translation, Ezra Pound was interested in energizing translation. Walter Benjamin highlights the pure language of interlineal translation. The German romantics like Goethe, Herder and Humboldt emphasized hermeneutics, which means the theory of interpretation of meaning. George Skinner, in his monumental book After Babel, Aspects of Language and Translation, Oxford University Press, published in 1975, hinges upon hermeneutic motion, or what you call hermeneutics of translation. Hermeneutics, as such, points to a theory of interpretation of meaning and takes us back to ancient Greece, and the modern hermeneutic movement owes its origin to the 18th and 19th century German romantics, among whom the names of Herder, Goethe, Schlegel, Wilhelm von Humboldt and Hölderlin and novelists stand prominent. In the 20th century, the hermeneutic method was followed by Gadamer and Heidegger, and George Skinner's hugely influential book After Babel throws sufficient light on Skinner's hermeneutics of translation. To Skinner, hermeneutic approach is the, I quote, investigation of what it means to understand a piece of oral or written speech, and the attempt to diagnose this process in terms of a general model of meaning. In his book, Skinner primarily focuses on the psychological and intellectual functioning of the mind of the translator. This is significant. Whereas cultural critics tend to explore the translator's cultural consciousness, refined mind and aesthetic taste, Skinner is more interested in the translator's emphasis on different meanings and the intellectual functioning of mind. At the same time, he tends to discuss the process of meaning and understanding. Please note two important words, process of meaning and understanding, that underlie the translation process. At the same time, by translation theory, Skinner means a theory of semantic transfer. I repeat, theory of semantic transfer. This transfer is either an intentionally serpent and hermeneutically oriented way of designating a working mode of all meaningful exchanges of the totality of semantic communication, including Roman Jacobson's intersemiotic translation or transmutation, or a subsection of such a model with special reference to interlingual exchanges to the emission and reception of significant message between different languages. While saying so, Stenner in fact points to the totality of semantic communication. I repeat, the totality of semantic communication. By totalizing model, under quote, Stenner tends to emphasize, following Roman Jacobson, translation in a wider compass by sharing features with the acts of communication. This totalizing endeavor is all the more instructive because it entails the fact that all procedures of expressive articulation and interpretative reception are very much significant. Stenner's hermeneutics of translation embodies four important parts. These are, number one, initiative trust, number two, aggression, number three, incorporation or embodiment or penetration, and number four, compensation. We shall discuss these four parts in detail, and that would constitute the core of my lecture with special reference to George Stenner's contribution to postcolonial translation. To begin with the first point, the translator's first endeavor, according to Stenner, is an investment of belief that the source text has something substantial to be understood. This is very much significant because before the translation takes place, the translator must have a strong trust in the source language and the source text. Two important things. Unless this fidelity in translation takes place, the translation process will be absolutely meaningless. It is this trust in the source language, please remember, in the source language and the source text, two things, ST and SL, source language and source text. It is this trust that strengthens a concentration of the human way of viewing the world symbolically. This reminds us of fidelity in literature, which was emphasized by George Orwell, who once said that where in the essay where I write that an artist is always faithful, or what you call fidelity to art, fidelity to life, fidelity to society, and fidelity to art. And likewise, we can apply George Orwell's observation to the translator. A translator must have fidelity to the source language and to the source text as well. Significantly, Stenner is of the opinion that there is something in the source text. The translator must strongly believe that this source text is meaningful and there is something significant in the source text. And with this primary trust, what you call the initiative trust, the translator should proceed for the next stage translation. The source text is therefore significant in translation. It is real and rather human. With this notion, the translator should proceed. And while doing so, he has to go for a coherent something. Mark the word, coherent something. That also contributes to Stenner's idea of a totalizing model, just emphasized by me a few minutes back. So it is the totalizing endeavor that is also significant in the context of coherent something that can be translated. And as such, for Stenner,
A translator cannot be absurd, incoherent, and sometimes translators become nonsensical, and Steiner is allergic towards this kind of approach, and he emphasizes that the translator must be serious enough to discover something that is coherent, something that is meaningful in the source text. So, this is the first point. Coherence, again, consists in totality. I repeat, Steiner's view of coherence consists in totality, not in fragments. The basis of a few pages of the source text cannot be called translation, or cannot be taken as the basis for translation, because translation involves totality, as I said, not the pages of something. And at the same time, Steiner also emphasizes the point that once the translator emphasizes the source text and the source language in its totality, then he sizes the meaning, which is the cardinal feature of hermeneutics of translation, because translation is the interpretation of meaning. According to the hermeneutics or hermeneuticians, translation is the interpretation of meaning. Now, this is first point. And after initial trust or fidelity in the source text, let us proceed to the second point of Steiner, which is titled as aggression. By aggression, Steiner means to repeat the Heideggerian view of translation as a violent, I quote, and appropriative move. And therefore, he calls translation nothing but aggression of an invader trying to erase the source text. Steiner also reminds us of Saint Jerome's view about a translator who comes home by bringing the source text as a captive slave by the colonial master. This is a post-colonial orientation to translation, because we are using two important words of master-slave narrative, that the translator is converted into a colonial master and the source text becomes a captive slave. This is aggression. And this aggressive mindset of the translator is also discernible, not only from his seizure of the source text, but from the extraction of meaning also. Like the invader exhausting the land or the landscape that he invades, some source texts are exhausted, are invaded, or you may use the word looted by the translator in course of his translation. This is what we discussed under the second part called aggression. As you remember, the first part was initial trust of the translator in the source text. Now the second point we discuss is the aggression, the translator's aggressive attitude to appropriate the source text. Steiner calls this aggression penetration. It is not an ordinary kind of aggression of an aggrandizer of attacking another's country. It is within the context of, in the context of translation or translation translatory activity called penetration. The translator must have the capacity to penetrate, and of course this has been criticized by many feminist critics for the violent male-centric sexual imagery called aggression. Be what it may, this is a stage of aggression, means to capitalize or appropriate the source text, because without source text, translation is unthinkable. Now the third important part is incorporation. This is most relevant in the context of the post-colonial discourse, because post-colonial discourse is essentially grounded upon the question of transaction and negotiation, which is often used in cultural studies and called cultural transaction and cultural negotiation. This starts third step, according to Steiner's hermeneutic method of translation, is incorporation, which is related to the meaning extracted by the translator in the stage of aggression and brought into the target text, TT, source text and target text, which has its own words and meanings. And once the aggression of the source text is done, the translator finally negotiates the source text with the target text, and because it has its own words and meanings. The stage of incorporation can be otherwise called a stage of negotiation that entails different types of assimilation. This takes place a complete domestication in which the target text takes its full place in the target language canon, or permanent strangeness and marginality. On the one hand, it involves a question of strangeness, as there is a question of importing of the meaning of the foreign text, which potentially dislocate or relocate the whole of the native structure. And the meaning is simple, because when a translator makes a trajectory into a source text produced in a foreign ethos, in the hands of a foreign author, the translator has to negotiate the foreign text with the native text, and this negotiation must be agreeable and must be grounded upon an agreeable affinity, must be fitted into the total framework of the native structure. So this is what we call it negotiation, and George Steiner has given the name incorporation. And Steiner suggests that there are two ways in which this process of negotiation between the source text and the target text takes place. And these two are, one is a sacramental intake, I quote from Steiner, sacramental intake, or as infection outside. Sacramental intake points to the indigenous framework of the native structure, and infection points to the outside aggression, as I already told you, of the source text upon the target text. The target culture either becomes enriched by the foreign text, or it is infected by it. So this is the dialectics, because the target text, when produced in form of translation, experiences these two kind of dialectical class. On the one hand, it is overpowered by the foreign text. On the other hand, it is also infected by the foreign text. And ultimately, it rejects, because translator has its own originality. And if he becomes completely infected by the foreign text, he loses his own originality. And if he goes far away from the original text, I mean the source text, then he becomes fictitious and he loses also originality. That way, a good translator or an ideal translator must maintain a balanced distance between the source text, the source culture, and the target text and the target native culture. This is what George Steiner wants to mean by pointing these two technical words, sacramental intake, which points to indigenous culture, and infection from outside, which points to the imposition of the source text or the foreign culture on the translated text and culture. Now, this dialectical class is very interesting, because the translator is always exposed to this kind of dialectical class between the source text and the target text, between the source language and the target language. Finally, it takes a reconciliatory term, which is called cultural negotiation, as had already been established earlier. Sacramental intake refers to the target culture in which he ingests and becomes enriched by the foreign text. That is why it is called sacramental intake. It is taking inside in a sacramental way, trying to enrich the target text by the foreign text. And as infection, the target culture is losing its beauty because of the dominance of the source text. And ultimately, the translator knows it very well and he rejects it and takes a balanced position. At this stage, the translator experiences the struggle called the dialectical possibility. I quote from Stenner. So this is the stage which is very important, a stage of negotiation, which is used in cultural studies also, which is called cultural transaction and cultural negotiation. And here, the translator takes a very wise position. After dialectical class, he takes a wider position to as to how much he should take from the source text and how much he should take from the indigenous culture. And there must be therefore a balanced and agreeable affinity between the source text and the target text. Hence it is called reconciliation, a stage of reconciliation. The third stage of this hermeneutic method of translation is called a stage of negotiation, a stage of reconciliation, a stage of incorporation. The translation has to be wiser enough to incorporate and to think how much he has to incorporate and how much he has to reject from the source text and the source culture, I mean foreign culture. Now, the fourth point is, according to Stenner, compensation. I repeat, the fourth stage is compensation. It is a stage in which the translation becomes a wiser text. The translator becomes a wise man in course of his aggression and in course of his incorporation, or what I said, negotiation. And he comes to a balanced stage, as I've already told you. And in aesthetics, it is called aesthetic distance. And the translator should not be a blind imitator of the source text, or should not be a blind slave to the source text, nor should he become fictitious by abandoning the source text, by setting aside the source text and writing something on his own, which is not possible in translation. Therefore, a translator must have a balanced position, and this balance is restored, and the source text is that way enhanced by translation. Source text is not rejected. The source text is renewed in a renewed form, and therefore translation is called transcreation. You know very well. Translation is called new writing. The old writing is converted into a new writing. Translation is called recreation, and translation is called representation, and that way transcreation. The dialectic of embodiment, on the one hand, the translator's energies can be enhanced, and on the other hand, his energies can be consumed by translation that saps the creative powers necessary for the production of his or her own works. Stenner sees such imbalance as stemming from a dangerously incomplete hermeneutic motion, and this balance can be restored by the act of compensation. Compensation is otherwise called the enactment of reciprocity. I quote, repeat again, the enactment of reciprocity, which is the crux of the matter and morals of the translation. The enactment of reciprocity, I've already told you, this negotiation never takes place lopsidedly or one-sidedly. There is a reciprocation and cultural amicable negotiation between the source text and the target text. And Stenner describes the aggressive appropriation and incorporation of the meaning of the source text, which leaves the original with a dialectically enigmatic residue. However, despite the loss for the source text, the residue is positive. Stenner considers the source text to be enhanced by the act of translation. The source text is represented in a dignified way, in a new ethos, in an altogether different ethos, and that way it is also enhanced by the act of translation. Enhancement is therefore a very powerful word in George Stenner's scheme of things. enhancement occurs immediately when a source text is deemed worthy of translation. And once it is chosen as and taken off as worthy of translation, the enhancement process starts. The dignified respect for the source text starts. And the subsequent transfer to another culture in form of translation broadens and enlarges the original. And that way, the source text is never neglected. It becomes dignified. Hence the importance of the term established by George Tanner in terms of enhancement. So the subsequent transfer to another culture broadens and enlarges the original. The source text enters into a range of diverse relationships with the target text, which is metaphorized as the echo and the mirror, all of which enrich the source text. And this is now how the source text is enhanced with resistant vitalities. So when the source text is transcreated, it becomes a mirror also. And at the same time, it becomes an echo also. These are the two words Steiner emphasizes in the process of translation. The enhancement takes place and the outcome is echo of the source text, the mirror of the source text in the target text. Now, there is another word he used, technical word he uses called imbalance. Imbalance, according to Steiner, is caused by the energy which flows out of the source text into the target text, altering both and altering the harmonics of the whole system. Such imbalance needs to be compensated. Hence the importance of this section called compensation. At those points where the translated text is lesser than the original, the translated text makes the original virtues more preciously visible. Whereas the translated text is greater than the original, it nevertheless identifies points in the source text that have the potential for enhancement and for the realization of its elemental results. In this way, balance and equity are restored. Please remember, this is a very significant line. In this process of negotiation, balance and equity are restored. This equity provides real, I emphasize, and ethical meaning to the concept of helpfulness. These three are key words so far as George Tanner's notion of translation is concerned. What are these words? Translation must be real rather than fictitious. Translation must be ethical. And at the same time, the translation should abide by the principle of fidelity, what you call faithfulness. The translator, like an ideal reader, is faithful to his text, makes his response responsible only when he endeavors to restore the balance of forces, those dialectical forces I have discussed earlier, of integral presence, which his appropriative compensation disrupted. So this is how that way the totalizing ideal is once again to be recalled here. It is a question of comprehensiveness, a kind of totality that rather than fragment that matters. Thus, Steiner is confident that this fluid, moral, balanced hermeneutic of trust would allow translation theory to escape the so-called sterile triadic model. I quote, sterile triadic model. What is sterile triadic model? Before George Tanner, there were three important methods of translation, which he says sterile triadic model. These are literary translation, free translation, and faithful translation. And George Tanner is therefore offering a kind of morally balanced hermeneutic method of trust by emphasizing the interpretation of meaning and form while doing the translation in the discourse. Now, he also uses two other powerful technical words. These are elective affinity and resistance difference. I repeat, elective affinity and resistant difference. So in the latter part of the chapter of the book, he talks about the hermeneutic motion, which is devoted to a detailed analysis of examples of literary translations, such as the translation of The Death of Virgil, name of the book, in 1945, jointly done by J.S. Untermeyer and Hermann Broch, the German translators. Stenner's observations in this regard are very much pertinent, so far as his notion of translation is concerned. To him, the translated text becomes in many ways indispensable to the original. So both are dependent upon each other. The beauty and the dignity of the source text is enhanced, I have told you a few minutes before, because of the translated text. And the translated text has no original existence at all without the source text. So that way, both the source text and the translated text are indispensable to each other. And here, Stenner says that the translated text is in many ways indispensable to the original. In the merging metasyntax of English and German, Stenner sees a kind of interlinear text close to the poet's dream of an absolute idiolect. Similarly, in Holderlin's translations of the Greek classics of Pindar and Sophocles, Pindar a Greek poet and Sophocles a Greek dramatist, in the first decade of the 1800, it is the verbal interlinear, a middle one between antique and modern, Greek and German, which attracts Stenner's praise. Stenner differentiates himself from the earlier translation theoricians, which had who have derided word for word a literal translation. Stenner's focus is on the word which can be circumscribed and broken open to reveal its organic singularity. So, importance of word and meaning. I repeat, for Stenner, the focus is laid on word and meaning. In Sanskrit, we call vak and artha, and in Kalidas, it is called vak and artha joined together give birth to a creation. Shiva and Parvati joined together give birth to a creation. Therefore, both vak and artha, word and meaning, are very, very significant according to Stenner's theory of translation. And these two taken together contribute to what Stenner says, organic singularity. Stenner feels that real understanding and translation occur at the point where languages diffuse into each other. This is a kind of negotiation which takes place, and the ability to move outside the self is the key. This insinuation of self into otherness is the final secret of the translator's craft. Here, Stenner justifies translation not only as an art, but also as a craft. Because the final secret of the translator's craft consists in this negotiation between the self and the other, which is a post-colonial cup of tea, because post-colonial theory is based on the binary relationship between the self and the other. Here, self is the original text and other is the targeted text, I mean the translated text. While speaking about Ezra Pound's art of translation of Chinese and Japanese texts, Stenner emphasizes the point that sometimes ignorance becomes an advantage because the more we are removed from the source text and culture, that allows the translator to work hard and diligently without preconceptions or the complications of mutual contact. I quote from Stenner's observation about Ezra Pound. The relations of the translator to what is near are inherently ambiguous and dialectical. The determining condition is simultaneously one of elective affinity and resistance difference. Now we are coming to two important points. With that we shall wind up. Now, to Steiner, resistance difference occurs in two ways. I repeat, to Steiner, resistance difference occurs in two ways. Number one, the translator experiences the foreign language differently from his or her mother tongue. Obviously, because the translator's mother tongue is, say, Indian, and the mother tongue of the writer of the source text is English. Now, number two, the relation between the source text and the target text differs and imposes its vivid differences on the translator and society. The resulting experience for the translator is all-encompassing and affects his or her very identity. This is very significant because the translator's identity is also coming up for the target text. This linguistic and cultural effect of resistance of difference may prevent the translator from penetrating and incorporating the original text. However, Steiner also sees this impermeability as being transcended by elective affinity. So, elective affinity, now we are coming to elective affinity. What is that? Elective affinity occurs when the translator has been drawn to that text as a kindred spirit and recognizes him or herself in it. When both resistant difference and elective affinity are present at the same time, the text both rejects and attracts the translator. So, this is a kind of philosophical and psychological approach. I try to understand this. Because when you find an aligned text, obviously you will be reluctant and you will have some kind of resistant difference. But the more you try and enter into it and find yourself engrossed in it, then you develop a kind of affinity. So your difference, your resistant difference is finally converted into a kind of elective affinity. And out of this height dialectical class, because we emphasize on the same thing between these two, between difference and affinity, finally a point of reconciliation emerges between the two texts, and the translator rejects something and assimilates something because he is guided by the theory of or the idea of resistant difference and elective affinity. So, out of this class, he has to reject something and has to incorporate something, and apart from being attracted by the source text also. This creates a creative tension, which is noticed in good translation. This is very significant, perhaps one of the most substantial contribution of George Steiner to translation, psychologically and philosophically satisfying. Out of this class between resistant difference and elective affinity, when the translator comes to an agreeable point, he experiences a creative tension. I repeat, a creative tension, which is noticed in good translation. Now, I quote Steiner. Good translation can be defined as that in which the dialective of impenetrability and ingress of intractable alienness and felt at homeness remains unresolved but expressive. Out of the tension of resistance and affinity, a tension directly proportional to the proximity of two languages and historical communities, grows the elucidative strangeness of the great tension. Unquote. In Steiner's view, the closer the two languages and cultures become, the higher the potential for unresolved tension, and therefore great translation paradoxically becomes translation between two distant cultures and languages, which is deemed to be trivial because tension is reduced. So Steiner's resistance difference and elective affinity are in an unresolved state of tension. And to wind up, George Steiner's contribution to the post-colonial translation consists in his hermeneutics of translation, his philosophical approach to translation, with emphasis on totalizing model and semantic transfer, and emphasis on word and meaning, and interpretative reception. And as I've already told you, the hermeneutics of translation is based on these four important methods which we have discussed, with emphasis on initiative trust, aggression, incorporation, and compensation, and finally, the dialectical clash between the two worlds, the resistant difference and the elective affinity. Out of this clash between these two worlds, a kind of creative tension is held, and this creative tension constitutes the hallmark of a good translator, of a good translation, according to Steiner. Thank you.